I made that abundantly clear quickly. Like, listen, I'm not the Holla Holla guy. I'm not going to put out or try to make a Holla Holla every album. That's not who I am. I'm an artist. From Hollis. Couldn't get and have things that I wanted as a young man, teenager growing up. You know, you want all the nice sneakers, you want things. So, you know, naturally I got into the easiest way there is to make money in ghettos of America, sell drugs. But all the while, you know, music was my thing.
Irv was instrumental to discovering him and nurturing him and bringing him along.
I met Irv Gotti through another friend of mine, my man Chris Black.
Him and Jai No One, and they was on the block hustling. He's like, yeah, my man to the left, they call him Jeff Left. He's like, yeah, left rap. The minute he rapped, I was blown away.
Don't risk it. Ja Rule's known for making heads split. Fully loaded clips and wax guitar with rap. Tap, tap, rewind the deck. Black, I got your mind wide open and your wick was back. So keep it coming. You don't want none, but you get some.
They have this big meetup in Def Jam. And from that point on, Leo sought out looking for me. And he said that. You know what I mean? He said, I only want the little guy.
You got Irv vouching, you got Jam Master Jay vouching, you got Leo believing, you got the young kid. You know, me, like, I just feel his voice is different from everybody else's.
I wrote the hook to Can I Get It? So when I created it, it was for my first album. You know, and then Jay heard it and he was like, oh, this is dope.
He said, just give me the record and we could put Ja on it and you're going to break Ja. I said, let me ask Ja. I said, Ja, what you think?
Well, that's cool. That's fine, Jay. Let's do it. You know what I mean?
It's no disrespect to Jay in any way, shape, or form. He gave him the hook and the bounce to it, and then Jay wrote his verse and he wrote Emil's verse. So Ja didn't write his verse, but Ja wrote the hook and we gave him the aura of the record.
Follow-up to that was Def Jam took the record and put it on the Rush Hour soundtrack.
Who wouldn't want to be part of a blockbuster movie with one of the greatest rappers of all time in Jay-Z?
That definitely changed my life. That one record, that one video, that one moment, everything was different.
Baby girl, best have my money for show before they go.
Your first album is always special.
Then you've had Avicii's All Pain and Hunger.
If there was any indictment you would make of the first album, it was that it completely ran out of gas as soon as Holla Holla finished.
We did like 2 million, his first album, right? But we was pissed. Because, you know, Jay and X was doing 7 million, 8 million, so we was like, fuck, this is 2 million-ish. Understand? So Ja would get in interviews and he would openly say, like, if he had Can I Get Her, that could have been my other single, and what it did for Jay could have did for me. And he wasn't wrong in saying that, but Jay didn't like that.
After the first album, I'm being compared to wannabe DMX, wannabe Tupac. So I go through that. So I say, you know what? The second album, I'm going to do something that nobody's expecting. So I grew my hair out. Big ass afro, went and got cornrows. Like, DMX and Pac don't look nothing like this. So I changed my look.
What was the thing that was going to separate you apart from the other artists that so many people were comparing to? Nobody was making those friendly, you know, female-driven records. To now, you're in a time that that's all everybody wants to make.
So when we went in and made 336, I made a conscious effort to make chick-friendly, radio-friendly records. But I said, Joe, don't be soft on these records. Lyrically, be a beast. Be hard and say fucking grimy shit. You know what I'm saying? So niggas is like, yo, he talking that shit though. That created the murdering sound. It created the sound that niggas is still fucking running with.
Everything that I was seeing now was light. And so I think the album reflected that. I'm out in LA for like 3 months, away from home, away from my wife, away from my family. And as you can imagine, we're having a lot of trouble at home. The trouble's mounting. I'm making records like Between Me and You. Keep it between me and you. The freaky little things that we do. And wifey's like, oh, that's what's going on out there? The freaky things that you're doing? It's between you and whoever, you motherfucker.
Put It On Me is an ode to his wife. Did he say that? Yes. because he was doing all that fucking dirt.
This is the mother of my children. This is the woman that I love. She's not understanding this whole issue right now, you know. I want to make a record that talks directly to her, because for me, as being a recording artist, what better way to express yourself to your woman or to the world than through song? But when I heard the beat, it came to me like that. Would I be without you? I only think about you, yeah. I know you're tired of being lonely, so baby girl, put it on me. And I'm like, that's it, let's go. That's it. Put the beat, I got it.
Baby girl, put it on me.
Would I be without you?
It was a bunch of sounds that was forced into making a melody. It wasn't actually, you can't really say like, okay, that's just pianos or that's just horns or whatever. It was just everyday sounds that some of them was truncated, some of them was stretched out to actually make a melody.
True Styles, that fucking clown.
Irv, he wasn't there. He didn't really add nothing to it.
If you hear what he did, you'd be like, that's not what it was. He wasn't in LA with us. He made a beat. Bling, 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 bling. We didn't even use what he did. And then we put the drums, the bass, we did everything to make the record.
Now, here's what Irv did. Irv did this. He did it with my record, too, because Can I Get It was one of the big records that they did. So he would use the Can I Get a snare on everything. So he used the snare from Can I Get On Holla Holla. He took my snare off and put that snare on. And then he did the same thing with Put It On Me.
Vita got signed through Hype. He pressed me. Because she didn't write rhymes.
No, how'd that come about? Because I never ran around saying I was ghostwriting. He already had a verse and the hook already done. I came in and I was like, oh, that's fine. He was like, yeah, I'm about to put, yeah, matter of fact, write that for da da da. And that's how that happened. I sat there, I wrote that shit quick.
And that was an anthem for women. Everybody went to House on the Hill. So when me and Caddy first heard the beat, we was in LA, we just collabed on it.
His story with his wife was similar to mine's with my wife. And I kind of just really took my situation and kind of put it there. I couldn't just have one of my verses and give to her and say, go ahead and spit it. It wouldn't come across like it was her.
What would I be without you?
That was my sorry, not paying my family enough attention. I'm out here, I'm fucking up, I'm being very selfish. It's not right, it's wrong. And I admit it, and here's the song and the record that you can always play for the rest of your life, that you'll know that I said sorry in a different way.
In hip hop, you could count on your hand records like that.
I thought Rule 336 was a dope album, so I came home happy. We bring the album back, and it was like the biggest shock of my life.
And I played that album for Leo and Kevin Lyles, and they
did a shit on me.
And Leo, it's the softest album. I hate it. Scrap it. I said, what you talking about? He says, make a new album. I said, you don't want none of these records? No, they're soft.
It's not like Vinny Vinny Vici, is what I kept hearing. I'm not in the hood struggling, eating hot dogs, noodles, and noodles no more, man.
It is my label. I don't put out music that I don't like or that I didn't feel is going to be good for the label. So I always try to push back on artists immediately just to make sure that they weren't sandbagging or they didn't have the opportunity to reach deeper.
See, in the office, I said, we going to go back in there. I'm going to go back in there and tell them I ain't changed this shit. I go back to the office. I said, yo, fuck that. We ain't changing nothing. Me and Rule said, the album is great. Okay. I said, what are y'all, you know, how are we rolling it out? We'll give you 2,000 pieces of vinyl and see what happens. So they set me up for failure.
On my own label. So, did he look sane to you?
So what they wanted was me to go out there and fall on my face. And for them to go, I told you, now make the other album.
I don't remember that.
You go from Holla Holla to that's a big difference. So our job is to gut check you. to make sure you believe in what you're doing. Don't just make records to make records, believe in those records. And if you want to put an album out like that, you better believe that you're ready for everything that comes with it.
And in Lior's defense, there had never been someone who was a credible rapper from a credible rap scene who just shot for the stars with total pop aspirations and did it successfully. Like, everyone who ever did that prior to Ja Rule ended up ethering themselves and looking like totally crazy. So you can understand why when they presented these records to someone like Lior or Kevin Lyles, they would be like, dude, you're gonna destroy your career with this.
I gave Flex the record and Flex do what he always do. He's going in, right? So I got New York. Damian Young is a program director for Power 106 in LA. So I told him my story. I said, yo, man, yo, could you play this record? I said, "Don't Def Jam ain't gonna call you." He's like, "Why? What happened?" I said, "Man, they said the album's soft." I said, "Yo, anything you could do, you know, I need your help. So if you could play it, because I felt if New York and LA play it, the cancer will spread, because they're the biggest markets." He did more than that. Then he can call program director after program director. Before you knew it, Between Me and You was the biggest record in the country without Def Jam picking up one phone call. So when we finished the album, we said Between Me and You was hot, but Put It On Me is the one, and held it. Let's get going with Between Me and You, get the energy, the album sold, and now we're going to ride out and kill his second single, smash.
Put It On Me is supposed to be played on the radio 100 times a week. Like, that's why you make a song like that. And they did it, and they did it perfectly. I don't have the BDS numbers in front of me, but I would be willing to bet that Put It On Me got more spins in 2000 than any Jay-Z or DMX record during that year.
This is also the reason why I turned into a huge asshole. Because imagine me and sitting in my shoes, and someone just shits on that fucking album.
And so they gave me my full rollout. Album does 4 million records. Everybody's happy.
Put It On Me on the album didn't have a little more. Females identify with females. So I wanted like a call and response on the hook.
She just changed the whole tone of that record.
She gave my wife a voice.
It was the secret sauce that made the record 10 times bigger than I think it would have been if she wasn't on it.
Hit him in the heart. I was like, hit him in the heart, yo. Make that voice and hit him in the heart. And I just put the battery in the back crazy.
They call that church sound, but they wanted it to just feel a certain type of way. Because it already felt good. But baby, I make it feel better. Hello.
As crazy as it may sound, I kept a hood. Like, even her dress and her attire, the braids, because I wanted every little Nico bitch in the hood to identify with her.
Urban and Purdy, he was like, this is a Nico smash. This is a Nico smash. You ready to be out of here, kid? This is a Nico smash.
I only think about you. I know you're tired of being lonely. So baby girl, put it on me. What would I be without you?
336 and Jay's album, a week apart. We outsold him.
A lot of people went out and bought the album, and that wasn't on there because that was like a remix of part two. So he got a lot of sales, but a lot of people was mad because they was just like, where am I at? So eventually, I believe they released it as a commercial single.
It's all hood-ish. There's nothing pretty about the video.
It's got to be yin and yang. Now, we got to go the opposite with the visual. So that's why I'm in jail in the video, and it just all makes sense, you know. I'm missing her because I'm away from her.
What would I be without you? I only think about you. I know you're tired of being lonely.
I'm making records that are for women. But at the same time, I'm like, smurder. it was a mind fuck for people. They didn't get it. But for me, that's who we are. That's who most people are. You understand? There's nobody that's all one way all day, every day.
He didn't make a pop record. He made a great record. He made a record that crossed all genres. Now, he wasn't chasing pop music. He was chasing a true Ja. And a true Ja talked to the ladies.
After Ja Rule, there's so much more collaborations and duets with singers and things. Come on, man. Murder, Inc. and Ja are imprinted on music today is still there, yo.
If someone was to do a movie about the summer of 2000 or the fall of 2000, Ja Rule has to be in the soundtrack. Absolutely, no question.
The legacy of Put It On Me is no fear or heart. And I think that's what's missing right now in hip hop. Motherfuckers are too scared, too worried about what this one or that one thinks. Just go in and make records from the heart, man.